This month's first reconstruction takes us back 2 months to a cold Wednesday in mid-January, and it takes us to a suburb of Cardiff, St Mellons. Claire Hood, a 15-year-old, was murdered while truanting from school. The whole community is anxious that her killer has still escaped detection and hope that in the next few minutes somebody will recall sightings or reawaken suspicions about someone who'd acted oddly at the time. The story starts and ends in Cath Cobb Woods.
Come on, let's shoot off to the bridge. No, come on,
eh? Did you see him?
Madam.
There's a guy over there with a hood on.
Where?
Over there.
Can't see no.
That's because she's too late. He's gone now.
Claire and her friends often played in Cath Cobb Woods. In fact, the woods are quite close to her home. Her parents were separated, so Claire and her younger sister lived with their mother. Claire was in her fourth year at Romney High.
Claire, you're late. I've already been to work and back, and you're still here. Out of bed, Claire.
All right.
That is the cold water treatment.
She was a great kid. She's not just a daughter, a friend. She shared my clothes with me. I shared her problems if she had any with her. Sometimes I had to play the mother.
Claire, I can't believe you're not at school yet.
I know, I'm going.
You can laugh, but I'm the one that has to answer to the teachers.
I know the pool competition. Get my trophy next week.
From the juice club?
Yeah, so they've engraved my name on it. I can't wait.
Great. First of many.
I know.
Yeah. Off to school.
See you later, love.
Okay, then.
Be back around about 7, usual time, all right?
Yep.
Okay.
True, Emma.
Bye.
Turn lamp, please. Come on, I'm gonna be late.
Good morning, lamp.
Go light.
Yeah.
Do you want to dance with me, Bill, me?
No, I can't. Why?
No, I'm just bored.
Claire, go ask for a cigarette, please.
No, it's my last one.
Okay.
This is the last definite sighting of Claire. Where did she go next?
Meadow.
When I turned round, this man suddenly appeared in front of me on the path. He was aged about 25 to 28 years old. He was about 5'6", 5'10". He wore dark clothes. His jacket had a hood, but it wasn't on his head at the time.
It's now 3:20. Was this Claire, or could it have been you?
Good boy.
You ready?
Yeah, almost.
You'll need that, it's freezing.
He obviously was in a great hurry. I would describe him as 5'6" to 5'8" tall, slight build, and dark complexion. The man seemed to come from the woods.
Claire?
Claire? Claire!
Awful thoughts were going through my mind, as it was out of Claire's character not to be there. I always knew where Claire was going, and she was never late from school anyway.
Elaine? Yeah, Claire, she's not around at your place, is she? No. She's not back, you see, and, well, I was just, I was just getting a little bit worried, because, you know, she never does things like this, no. Well, did you see her leave school, or...? No, I gotta go. I'm gonna try and ring Kelly. I've rung round all her friends, and nobody seems to have seen her, you see, and... All right, yes, I'll do that. I'll ring the police right now.
Called the police. I then began a search with some friends around the area of St. Mellon's. I felt I had to do something myself. And we ended up in Cathcart Woods. A last resort, really.
Oh, she'll be fine.
Oh, God. Oh, I'm so...
She'll be fine.
What am I going to do?
Look down 3 years, eh?
Yeah. Right. Well, we'll find her.
She'll be okay.
Anything
we'll
over there?
Her.
No. Oh.
Come on, this way.
It was freezing that night. Claire's body was discovered in the morning. She'd been sexually assaulted. I know you've had overwhelming help from the local community, Colin Jones, but you still want to get to new witnesses. Now, tell me who. You were telling me just before we came on air, people in Cathcart Woods, even though they didn't know Claire had nothing to do with this, you still want everybody who's been in the woods to talk to you. Why?
That's right. Well, we're working on the theory that the person responsible for this had an intimate knowledge of the woods, and therefore these people may have seen the culprit in the woods on a previous occasion.
Even though they had no idea of that, you still want everybody to come forward?
Yes, everyone that uses those woods, please could they come forward, whether it was on the 18th or prior to the 18th of January this year.
What about friends of Claire?
Well, there's been a general reluctance by some of the friends of Claire to tell us all that they know in relation to the Cathcart Woods or indeed habits of Claire. I think there's a variety of reasons for this. That's all I can assure them. They have my personal assurance that they will not get into any trouble. And I ask them to impart in us any information that they're withholding.
So if they've been truanting from school or underage smoking or anything else, you're not interested... I mean, this is a murder inquiry, you're not interested in that.
That is correct.
Will you protect them from that?
Yes, I shall. I have my personal assurance.
OK. You have actually got some other sightings of youngsters in the woods at the time. Just tell us about that.
Yes, we have a sighting at 3:20 of a girl standing on a bridge. And to that end, we're appealing for anyone to come forward. Also, there's a motorist who saw three children, school children, run across the Willowbrook Drive towards the general direction of the woods. Two boys and a girl. It's possible that the girl was Claire.
But if not, or even if it was, you desperately need them to come forward.
We desperately need them to come forward,
OK,
yes.
This is Wednesday the 18th of January. Now, there was a man also, apart from the one that we've seen, somebody else seen coming out of the woods.
Yes, at 25 past three, a man was seen running from the general direction of the woods across Willowbrook Drive towards Brookfield Drive. He's described as being 6 foot tall, slim build, fair complexion, fair hair, and had some distinctive clothing.
He had this, or at least this is a replica, of the fairly distinctive hat he was wearing. We should stress, he's not a suspect. You want him to come forward to eliminate himself.
Yes, we would like this person to come forward to eliminate himself.
OK. If there's any way that you can help, please do, particularly if you're a youngster. You haven't come forward up to now because you're worried you might get into trouble over something. I mean, don't worry about that. Call us, please, 0500 600 600. It's a free call here to the studio in London. If you prefer, you can dial the Rumney Police Station in Cardiff. That's on 0122 277 4285. That's 0122 277 4285. Thank you. Margaret Wilson was 66, a great-grandmother and a popular figure in the little village where she lived, Burton Fleming in East Yorkshire. On Thursday, February the 9th, in the middle of the afternoon, someone, for no reason anyone can think of, ran after her down a country road and killed her. Two people witnessed the whole thing. The Wilson family have farmed at Eastfield for three generations, and till last month, Margaret, together with her husband, still helped out their son.
Is he all right?
You get yourself inside, Mum. I'll shift it later.
The son, Alan, took over this farmhouse 12 years ago, and his parents moved down to the village. But this home remained the focus for all the family, including Margaret's daughter, Heather.
Hi, Mum. Look, I've got to go. I've just dropped some stuff off for Dad. I'll be late for work. I'll see you on Thursday, though, about 2 o'clock.
Oh, lovely. And drive carefully.
She's a very homely person. Her life revolved around the family. She loved the children. And now the grandchildren, any children, she just absolutely loved. She loved the countryside. She had to go for a walk every day to get some fresh air. She thought fresh air was the cure for everything.
Thursday, the 9th of February. This is Burton Fleming, a mile from the family home.
It was very cold. On the Wednesday night, we'd had a little bit of snow. I noticed a white car coming up the road. I saw the car 4 times, what I'd call crawling up and down, really slowly. I wondered what it was up to.
It was a white Montego estate with black roof rails and with black plastic trim along the side. Just round the corner is the house that Margaret and her husband had moved to.
Oh, there you are, just in time. I've made this pie for young Mark.
Oh, Mum, you shouldn't have. Mind you, he'll love it.
Thanks.
When I visited, I would very often go home with some sort of home-cooked something or other. She was just very thoughtful.
Oh, no more for me, thanks, Mum. Really, I must be going.
OK, love, I'll come with you if you don't mind. I need some fresh air. Just drop me off down the road.
That afternoon, two tractor drivers were working close to the Wilsons' farm.
Hey, Martin, what do you want to do at this headland? Do you want to go up it?
I don't know. I think if we go back to the other end, by the time we get back to this corner, it'll be about 4 o'clock. It'll be time for me to go home.
Meanwhile, back in the village.
Just take me down to Eastfield. That'll give me 20 minutes' walk.
Fine, okay.
I heard a car slowing, so I stopped. It was a wave of staring. It was frightening. Very frightening. I wanted to run.
Now, have you seen that bloke over there? Looks like he's running after Mrs. Wilson.
Bloody hell, he's jumped her.
By the time we'd got sort of halfway across the field, the man was just about run back to his car. So as we reached the road, he was in his car and driving off.
Martin, over here.
There's been somebody attacked down by the road. Can you get an ambulance?
You know what? What's happened?
Have you got a telephone?
Yeah, of course.
I just got hold of her hand, her arm, and you could tell there was nothing there. It was something that I couldn't really believe, even though I was there, holding her hand. But somehow it wasn't my mother. I just couldn't believe it.
Tony Corrigan, this is an appalling crime, and I know it's one that you fear could be repeated in time. You've actually, apart from the car, which we'll come to in a moment, you've not got an awful lot on the man, have you?
Well, one would think so initially, but actually when we look at the few clues we have, we can in fact eliminate a good percentage of the population. Now, the man we're looking for, he's described as 6 foot tall. He's described as about 30 years of age. He's got brown hair, collar length, and it's flicked up at the edges. He also, he ran 350 yards to kill Mrs. Wilson, and then he sprinted 350 yards back to his car. Now, to do that, he must have a reasonable degree of fitness. We don't say he's fat or thin, but he was certainly fit. Now, the type of man who might do this, he could come from anywhere in the country. The description is vague, but it eliminates a lot of people.
Now, we've got a video fit of him. One of the witnesses came down to London. This is the first time any picture of him has been shown. I don't know how confident you are of this, because obviously the witness at the time didn't realise anything about the seriousness of what might follow.
Yes, it's only a description, it's an artist's impression, but I wouldn't want anyone to sit at home thinking they know who the killer is, but not telephone us, because he simply doesn't fit all the exact description of our offender on the profile.
Now, one of the things that you know, or pretty sure about the offender, is that he felt very comfortable using knives.
The style of killing Mrs. Wilson indicated the killer was very, very comfortable holding a knife. Now, when we look at that, we think, well, is he a serviceman? Has he worked in the industry whereby he's been killing animals?
We're very reluctant, for very obvious reasons, to show murder weapons on this programme. It's ghoulish, apart from anything else, but the detectives are very, very anxious that we show you this. Now, why are you so keen that viewers should see this knife?
Well, first of all, the knife, which has a 4-inch blade and is made by Adams, of a Sheffield company, the blade itself is actually discoloured. It's blackening across the blade. Mm-hmm. We have failed to establish what caused that. It's some continual cutting created, but we haven't determined what it is. So I'd ask the viewers, first of all, do you recognise a knife? Is one missing? And importantly, what has a knife been used for?
Now, this car, that's the best clue you've got. Yeah. Now, we should point out, you don't want people to ring and say, oh, well, I happen to know somebody's got a white Montego estate with these black bits of trim and black rails on the top, because there are tens of thousands of them. You know them all.
Yeah, quite, tens of thousands. But if we can connect the Montego car, estate car, a similar car, with the knife, with the description of our offender, we will eliminate a lot more people and get closer to the suspect.
OK. Now, there is, in addition to this white Montego, another car. This one is not a suspect at all. It's a possible witness. Tell us about it, can you?
A most important witness. It's a red GTI-type car with a spoiler, travelled past the scene towards Burton Fleming, just prior to Mrs. Wilson being murdered. That driver may unwittingly have invaluable information for us, and I'd ask him or her to contact us immediately.
OK, this is at 3:30 p.m. Thursday, February the 9th. It's exactly 5 weeks ago
today. 5 weeks
today,
yes.
So if that could have been you, please call. If there's any way that you can help at all, please call. And that's 0500 600 600. It's a free call. 0500 600 600. Many of the detectives on the case are actually here in the studio, but their colleagues are in the incident room, and you can call that too. It's on 0148 285 6556. That's 0148 285 6556. Now to Merseyside and to the Wirral. Someone in the area is violently disturbed, but may not show it. 2 weeks before Christmas, he indulged in a calculated, ritualistic murder. But his behaviour at the scene was so controlled, it's possible he showed no signs to his friends of what he'd done. Now, perhaps you know someone who maybe is generally a little odd, who lives in the area, who acted strangely in the past, and perhaps he has a history of trouble and has previously been violent. His victim was 74-year-old Alice Rye from Spittle, and many of her neighbours have helped us reconstruct what happened. Alice had been recruited to the Women's Institute by her close friend and neighbour, Phyllis Kellett.
When we went to meetings and they were asking for people to be on the committee, and I'd be saying, come on, Alice, let your name go forward. And she'd be saying, oh, no, no, I couldn't go on a committee. And she did get onto the committee, of course.
New Year.
Oh, how lovely.
So I'm planning a long break down with one of my daughters.
Oh, your daughter's down in Surrey.
It's going to be lovely.
Alice was born and bred in Newborough, North Wales. She trained as a wartime nurse with her sister Anne.
I'm the eldest. But she's only 15 months younger than me. But she could put me in my place, mind you. She was that type of girl. We were very, very near. We did everything together, but she got married during the war, 1944, and travelled the world with her husband.
Her husband, Colin, died in 1986, and Alice turned more than ever to her neighbours.
If there was any social occasion, we might go together, and we helped each other when we could, when she was away, which was quite a lot with the family. I just went into her house, you know, and just had a look all round and did whatever was necessary.
Yes, it's me.
I've just been in to see Geoffrey.
So I thought I'd pop in and see you two. Not disturbing you, have I?
No, of course not.
I called in on the Sunday because I said I won't be able to see you for a few days, but come if you need anything.
I'm going to be away for a whole month.
So that was how it was, you see, and it was just a kind of help each other relationship.
Two days later, Tuesday the 10th, and Alice was out and about as usual.
I can't stop, Alice. I'm just going to catch the post.
Oh, I do. I'll catch you some other time.
That afternoon, I didn't see Alice go out, but usually she would have a walk around the estate, a fairly long walk.
Well, I knew Alice from church. I did come along Poulton Road in good time to meet my grandson from school. So I was driving quite slowly when I saw Alice coming out of the slip road.
This is the last known sighting of Alice alive.
Whilst I was doing the vegetables, I heard this almost like a wailing noise, and it went up to a crescendo as though somebody was in pain. It came 3 times, and I thought, if that happens again, I must do something about it. But it didn't. So I just went in and didn't think anything more about it.
Forty-five minutes later, these local residents were driving past the slip road that leads to Alice's house on Poulton Road.
I had a hospital appointment at 6 o'clock.
And if we go down the Lever Causeway...
Just as we got to near the slip road, a man walked out in front of us, completely oblivious to anything that was going on. He was about 5'11", late 20s, early 30s, quite powerfully built, his hair shortish but wavy at the side. His eyes were focused on the other side of the road and he just kept walking. Didn't react at all. This was what was so strange.
This couple were returning home just opposite Alice's house.
I wonder who these are.
I have no idea.
I was suspicious when I saw the car simply because it was parked in a place where visitors don't normally park. I was a bit unnerved at this. I just felt dubious of their presence.
Do you think we should call the police?
I wouldn't worry about it, Lovelace, going.
No, I don't like it.
Can you eliminate the two people in the white car?
After a few minutes, the car came into the drive. There were a young couple in their 20s. He was slim-featured. He had dark hair, swept back, and she was a young girl with a fuller face. She had shoulder-length hair, which looked brown.
At 8 o'clock next morning, I looked out and noticed that the gates were open. And I began to wonder why. By this time, I was quite concerned in that there was something not as it should be.
Alice?
I went upstairs. I just simply froze at the horror of what I saw.
Alice's body was in the spare room. She'd been stabbed and by now had been dead for some hours.
I'm trying to pretend that she's still there. And then it comes over you that she's not there. But that's the only way I think I can live, is to pretend that she still is. And what else can I do? Nothing else I can do, is there?
George Denson, what can we do?
We need to eliminate these people from the inquiry. I don't think there might be anything sinister in these sightings, but we need them to come forward so we can do that.
So that's the guy who was walking across the road, not paying a lot of, seemingly in his own thoughts, not paying much attention to the traffic, and the couple in the white car.
That's correct, yes.
Tuesday, the 10th of December. Now, some things were left in the house, and some things were taken from Alice's house. They're obviously a good clue. Tell us about this first, which was left in Alice's place.
This is a copy of a triangular bandage, which we believe the offender left at the scene.
Now, you don't want to know where triangular bandages come from. These brought anywhere. This had bits cut off it. Corners indeed. There. This was a triangle, which obviously there's a bit missing there.
That's
up,
right.
Up here.
It's been deliberately cut with obviously a blunt pair of scissors or some instrument. And what we need to know is, has anybody seen the missing pieces of this particular bandage?
Not pleased to ring us if you've just seen a piece of bandage. Does it connect with something that we've said tonight, perhaps in the introduction, about the sort of man that might be responsible? Now, what about the things that were taken? I know this is very, very important. Describe why this is significant to me, will you?
Yes, this is... Alice's husband had four of these made from one long chain.
So four of these identical ones?
Identical ones. So in that sense, they're unique. We know Alice very rarely took hers off, not even for bed. It's missing from the body, and... we know where three of them are, with her three daughters, two daughters and daughter-in-law, so we need to know where the missing bracelet is.
So if you've seen this, it could lead us to the killer.
It could indeed.
Her watch is missing too, yeah?
Yes, that's a lady's Omega watch with a gold bracelet and a champagne face.
Okay.
And there is a small gold brooch which has three pearls running through the centre, and she would use that to clip her scarf to her cardigan.
All of this is a very long shot. perhaps the longest of all, her travel zone, Merseyside travel zone, pass is missing. If you've seen that, would have her details on the back of it, her access card and other details. This man has to be caught. If you've any suggestions, please call us right away. There's the number, the free call line's here to the studio, or you can ring the incident room in Wallasey, that's on 0151 777 2920, 0151 777 2920.